Hello, this is a prepaid collect call from
an inmate at the Fox Lake Correctional Institution. All calls, other than properly placed attorney calls, may be monitored and recorded.
To accept charges, press 1. To refuse charges, press.
Thank you for using
CenturyLink.
You may start the conversation now.
Hello. Okay. My name is Ramiah Whiteside, and I currently contribute to Incarcerated Voices in a freeform radio initiative because I think it's an opportunity to shed some light on kind of this issue of things, because a lot of times people kind of develop the wrong impression of what happens on this side of those barbed wires and what happens leading up to it. So with that being said, I'm just going to share some of what happened in my life to lead up to my incarceration, my current incarceration. I am one of over 2 million people incarcerated in warehouses in a prison in America, and I'm one of the many unfortunates who know that this sad reality is another first for America to lead the world in, and that's incarceration rates. I've been incarcerated in the state of Wisconsin for over half my life, a state that leads the whole nation in locking up African Americans, and I feel real special about that. So I'm sharing these facts. I want sympathy, you know, rather I'm real grateful for the opportunity to kind of open up this dialogue, because at the end of the day, we can come up with something better than this. And I say we because although I'm not in the community physically, I'm still a part of the community because I still interact with people on a day-to-day basis. You know, I call home, I have visits. The young guys come through here and, you know, we associate with each other. So our connection to the community is ongoing, you know, whether people want to accept that or not. So that being said, my personal journey towards incarceration actually began at a young age. And just like anyone else, you know, I had no choice where I was born or who I was born to. And like so many others before me and so many others that are going to come after me, I was born into a kind of a recipe for what I term Gulag Gumbo. And in a nutshell, Gulag Gumbo, some of the ingredients are this. You know, I was born to a single mother with a big cup of no father. I was born in the ghetto with extra sources of violence, drugs, and gangs on the side. I was born in an area with a high unemployment rate, with poor schools, with an extra dose of indifference and apathy. And then sparingly add heavy doses of trauma. So Gulag Gumbo just let all that simmer. And now you add as much as you want spices and seasonings of anger, you know, hunger, poverty, hopelessness, fear, despair, bitterness, unfairness. You got to add a little racism and a lot of pain. Stir all that in the pot. You know, these are only some of the basic ingredients of what goes into that Gulag Gumbo that the majority of people incarcerated across America have tasted. For me, I had my first bowl at about the age of 5 when I witnessed my mom being brutally beaten and raped. So this experience had a very damaging impact on me. You know, when people use the term arrested development, that's what comes to mind. But, you know, when I reflect back, there was a lot more to it than just that. You know, I wasn't born to hate people, or I wasn't born with the desire to hurt another human being, you know, but my circumstances, my environment, were a huge factor in how I developed. So I didn't just have an arrested development. My development took a complete turn, you know, a dysfunctional turn. So it wasn't just arrested. It just went to the kind of dysfunctional, abnormal side at a very early age. So before I could even digest, you know, this first bowl that I had with witnessing what happened to my mom, you know, I get the second bowl. I get the third bowl and the fourth and the fifth bowl. They just come at you and come at you. And I'm a kid. I have no control over what happens. You know, I got the daily emotional and verbal abuse, you know, horrific beatings with anything at that hand, telephone cords, extension cords, bats, broom handles, mop handles, that it was. You know, then you have experimenting with, like, marijuana and alcohol. I throw that in the pot. Then you have, for me, I have my first exposure to death at a very young age. You know, this is all part of my, you know, gulag gumbo that at this age, these early ages that I'm, you know, that I'm eating. So by the time I get to around like 8 or 9 years old, you know, I don't even remember, you know, how many days I went hungry or how many days, you know, I missed school or how many days in a row that I wore the same old tore up and beat up underwear, you know. Looking back, I can remember the days where I had all the holes in my shoes. I remember the dark nights, you know, we had no electricity, and we had to sleep with, like, layers of blankets because we had no heat. You know, so when people see, you know, a guy or a woman that's incarcerated, they don't see any of this. You know, so these are the type of things a person never, ever forgets. You know, it's like the first time you have an older sibling play a trick on you and you... they have to drink pea-flavored Mountain Dew. It's something you never forget. You know, so, you know, I think good times, right? So, by the time I turned 14, you know, I had no idea how many different schools I attended. I had no idea how many different homes I lived at or been at, whether that was with family, friends, foster homes, or group homes. And as far back as I can remember, you know, I was a part of a chick case or a family court. And this is early in my life. So, you know, I basically was inside of a courtroom or going in front of a judge my whole life before I even understood what was going on. You know, so the chips cases, you know, eventually that morphed or, you know, transitioned into delinquency cases, you know, because I kept running away. I didn't want to live with strangers. I wanted to be, although my mom was dysfunctional and my environment was dysfunctional, it was all I knew. You know, so then being a runaway introduced me to being a juvenile delinquent in a detention center. So that was early on. So stir all that in the pot, you know, let that simmer. So I think looking back at my life now, I can see a lot of the transitions that I made from, like, one negative label to the next. You know, I went from being a neglected, abused child to being a runaway. I went from being a runaway to being a juvenile delinquent. I went from being a juvenile delinquent to being a street thug. You know, I didn't think it at the time, but it kind of seemed like, you know, the older I got, the more weight, the more pressure there was, and the more kind of life or circumstances just kind of just, you know, kept beating me down. That's how it seemed at the time. You know, the world around me, it was not, you know, the Cliff Huxtables or, you know, that rosy, wonderful life. You know, I guess if you live in a jungle, sooner or later, you are either going to learn how to survive or you're going to die. And that's a fact. I don't care how anybody wants to look at it. That's a fact. You learn how to survive with what you have available. Nobody's going to hold your hand. You know, so by the time I turned 16, you know, I made the transition from being hopeless and having despair to, you know, bitterness and just hate, you know, anger, you know. You know, through it all growing up, you know, the hardships, the trauma, I always had at least one, like, good thing. I had a best friend, I had a homie, and his name was Easy. And out of everything, you know, all the stuff that I've already talked about, you know, being rejected and being on the outside of everything, you know, he was always there. You know, and to say that we were close, that's an understatement. You know, we were really brothers. And, I mean, we did everything together. We grew up like little bitty shorties all the way up to teen years. You know, we went from collecting matchbox cars to, you know, wanting to get our own cars. We went exploring together. We learned how to do flips together. When he got beat up by a girl, I got in trouble because I tried to fight the girl, you know. That's very, very close. And his background was a little bit better than mine. So, you know, even though I started hanging out with, like, the wrong crowd or, you know, the thug crowd as we got older, he never did. Never, ever, ever did. You know, he wasn't plugged or none of that stuff. You know, his connection to anything was me because I was his best friend. So, you know, he was a square. And He never really liked the crowd that I hung out with. So, but he followed me anywhere. I followed him anywhere. So, you know, when the world judged me, rejected me, or whatever, he never did that. I was cool with him no matter what. So, whenever the world fed me another bowl, you know, that Gulag Gumbo, you know, he'd help me eat it. So, you know, I was probably told, I don't know, thousands of times I wouldn't, you know, I would end up in prison or probably dead, you know, by the time I was like, you know, 16. So I heard it so much, I stopped even fearing it. I stopped even worrying about it. I started expecting it. I started to embrace it. You know, and that was for me. You know, I never thought in a million years that Izzy would, you know, get killed or end up in prison. You know, he had his whole life ahead of him. And that was the expectation. So when he ended up getting killed, you know, whatever innocence or whatever hope I had left, it died. When he died, it died. You know, my world completely went dark. My heart turned to stone. And, you know, it's just like that. One minute he was breathing, and the next minute he stopped. And, one minute he was struggling to really breathe, and the next minute he was choking on his blood from being shot. So that's how that went. And, so without him to encourage me and keep me anchored, you know, I started to hustle more. I started to be in the streets a lot more. I just gravitated towards the negative and the hate even more. I ended up dropping out of school because I figured, why go to school? I'm not going to live two lives. You know, I'm not even planning on living very long, so why am I going to go to school? So with this attitude, by the time I turned 17, you know, I was already on my way to prison. So all the running away and the detention stays prepared me for juvenile correctional centers. And all the juvenile correctional centers prepared me for prison. So that being said, I was waived into the adult system at the age of 17 for weapons possession and marijuana trafficking. And now, actually, that's ironic because what I went for prison for the first time is actually legal in some states. So, you know, go figure. But being in prison at a young age, you know, it hurt me more than helped me. You know, the fear that I had, I was either too young or too stupid to admit that I had it. You know, and it eventually turned to just more anger and more hate. And unfortunately, that was not my last bit. So you turn the heat up all the way and let it boil on that pot. And once I was released back to the community, I was even worse off than when I left. And I don't blame the prison system for that. I don't blame anybody. You know, this is not about blame. It's not. You know, so I was barely out for 6 months before I was involved in a high-speed police chase. And that ended in 4 fatalities, and one of which was my younger cousin. So, I, you know, people have asked me over the years, you know, what was I thinking when I was fleeing and what was going through my mind and that type of thing. And, you know, honestly, I was scared to death, you know, but I wasn't scared about coming back to prison. Prison, for me at that time, from already having my first bit done, was not scary, okay? I was more scared to, like, face my family from getting my younger cousin in trouble. You know, I was more scared of what the police would do to us if they caught us, you know. So that's what was going on in my mind. It wasn't, you know, about me, per se, being worried about going to prison. Prison was not a worry at the time. So that was, you know, 20 years ago. And, you know, one of the main reasons I choose to share some of my story and my life, you know.
You have 1 minute left.
This type of audience is because nobody, you know, is born bad. Nobody is born to hate. You know, every incarcerated person has a story. And it is true that, you know, not everybody that goes through tough times end up in prison. But it's also true that everybody in prison has gone through tough times. You know, it's not about getting sympathy. It's about stopping, you know, this epidemic from happening because it's unnecessary. So that being said, I hope this is helpful to help people kind of understand some of the things that a lot of people go through that leads up to an incarceration. I'm not the person I was, you know, 20 years ago, 25 years ago, but that also is a process. My process that led me to prison, I just shared some of it. And when we understand those parts of the thing, then we can stop people from ending up overdosing off that Gulag Gumbo. So thank you guys for listening.
Thank you for using
for help.
Century Link.
Goodbye.